Hey everyone, welcome to Tent Talk, the Farmers Market Podcast. This podcast is all about farmers markets, how to increase your market business success while providing people with fresh food. Farmers markets are essential. Whether you're a farmers market manager or a small farmer or food maker selling at farmers markets, you have found just the right podcast. This week we're chatting about all that goes into reopening a farmers market that closed during the first wave of COVID-19 shutdowns. I'm one of your hosts, Bridget Myers. I'm a longtime farmers market manager, Vendor 101 co-teacher, and education coordinator at Farmers Market Pros.
And I'm Kat Fields White, director of San Diego Markets, still an active farmers market manager, founder of Farmers Market Pros, and host of Intense, the Farmers Market Conference, and the Farmers Market Pros community.
And I'm Justine Marzoni-Mead, Tent Talk producer, marketing director for Farmers Market Pros, and logistics coordinator for Intense, the Farmers Market Conference, 2022.
Today's episode of Tent Talk, the Farmers Market Podcast, is made possible by the attendees and sponsors of Intense, the Farmers Market Conference. When you attend the next annual conference in March 2022, you'll gain knowledge, networking, inspiration, and also the satisfaction of knowing that you helped support the ongoing education provided here to farmers market participants, large and small, throughout the U.S., Canada, and beyond. Super early bird pricing ends this week. So register today and save at intenseconference.com or on the Conference 2022 page at farmersmarketpros.com/conference.
All right, well, welcome back to Tent Talk, everyone. Today we are talking about reopening a farmer's market that has been dormant for over a year. There is a lot that goes into jumpstarting an inactive market, from vendors to neighbors to city permits. I'm going to add to no parking signs. And it's almost as tough as launching a new market. It does kind of feel like launching a new market, although you kind of have that little fan base that's been waiting.
Yeah, fan base that's been waiting, but there's also some lingering impressions, especially because we closed very rapidly during COVID. So it's a little bit, it's like opening a new market, but it's also sort of like taking over a market and doing a turnaround like we did with a market years ago, 8-9 years ago, when we took a market that was struggling that somebody else had and we took it and turned it around. We said after that, we'll never do this again because it's harder than starting
you say
a
that
new
a
market.
Lot. Yeah.
Well, I've noticed mostly we don't do those things again.
We try.
We never say never, but so it's tricky.
Give a little background too. So we have a Saturday market in Little Italy that's been around since 2008. Going strong every Saturday. And then we opened a Wednesday morning market in 2018. July of 2018. Got it started. There was a big desire for people to have a weekday market in that neighborhood downtown. And it was great. And it was a great market. It was strong. It was growing. We were in our first couple years of business.
First year and a half,
So about a year and a half old. And then when everything happened with COVID at first in March of 2020, we decided to just close the Wednesday market and focus our attention on the Saturday market and operating that market during the insanity of the COVID protocols that we needed to follow. We had, you know, staffing situations.
Well, and it was partly an issue with the city, too, is that we were closed down by the city, by the city, county, state triumvirate, and their misunderstandings between each other about how farmers markets should operate. Yeah. And it was crisis time for everybody, obviously. And so when we were allowed to reopen the Saturday market, it was because it was an essential service for people to buy their groceries. There were no grocery stores in downtown in that area.
Yeah.
It was hard to make the case that it was essential for them to have that both days. So that was part of the reason. And then also the smaller market with all the extra staffing and things required to run markets under COVID protocols, that was tough on the big market financially. It would have, there would have been no way to do it on the smaller market and have enough money to remain sustainable and to operate.
And the farmers and vendors needed to decide which markets during that time when not every market was open, which markets they could safely attend and that would be worth it for them. So
it made more sense for them to spend that day of the week in a completely different neighborhood that also needed to be able to buy groceries safely outside and to come back to the neighborhood where they were on Saturday.
So, you know, we just kept saying we'll reopen Wednesday, you know, when we get our feet kind of on the ground here and when things are different protocol-wise and market rules-wise. And I know in Southern California, it was a long, you know, we had to wait probably like the longest to have like a no-mask mandate at our markets and things like that. And so it was a while before we even could think about jumpstarting the Wednesday market again. So,
and before we had the bandwidth to do so,
exactly.
We were so just like in the thick of it, we really couldn't see the forest through the trees
Yeah.
Until a couple of months ago where it was like even an option for our team to pull it off.
Yeah,
for sure. So then the interesting thing, though, was the Wednesday market opened because the Saturday market was so busy that the neighbors and the chefs in the neighborhood were having a hard time making their way through the Saturday market to get their groceries.
Yes.
And so they loved the Wednesday market for that reason. And so the entire time, or maybe not the first few months, but since then, we've had a steady drumbeat of neighbors who keep saying, when's the Wednesday market coming back?
Yeah. And people asking about it in response to our email newsletters. People would be commenting on social media and sending us messages all the time being like, when's the market coming back? When's the Wednesday market coming back? And for a long time, it was just kind of like, we'll see, you know, or stay tuned.
Yeah.
So I think that's, you know, part of the decision in deciding to reopen. And I will say there are some markets across the country that still haven't reopened and may never reopen because we had to kind of reevaluate, is there still a demand there for this market? Have people, have vendors, have farmers made other plans and moved on with life and aren't? So it's a big consideration. You can't just automatically assume that you should open a market on the same day and the same time, the same location as you had prior to COVID.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you haven't reopened yet, you got to kind of do that whole analysis. And in that way, it is much like launching a new market. You have to decide, is there a demand for this at this point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. It just felt like kind of opening a new market and reintroducing it to people. And we already knew that there was people that wanted it because they were telling us because they already knew about it. But, you know, in a lot of respects, it just felt like a brand new thing.
Yeah, yeah, and part of knowing whether or not it was time to reopen was also talking to vendors and, you know, first checking in with those vendors that were either at the market before or kind of those OG long-term vendors that we have really close relationships with and kind of, you know, floating the idea to them and saying, you know, if we reopen the Wednesday market, are you with us?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of them said yes, and some of them were kind of like, you know, in the interim, they'd made other plans. They had found other markets or they realized that they need a day off or they're having staffing issues, too, or it's just not the right time for them to add another market to their circuit. So that was a big part of taking the vendor's temperature and seeing if they're able to do it before we really decided to go forward and reopen that market.
Yeah. So it took a while. It was a lot of analysis. We kept hearing from the people that were really enthusiastic about us reopening. Well, let's do it now. Let's do it now. I said, you know, we have to figure this out. Are there enough vendors to make this make sense? Are there enough farmers available to be a farmer's market?
Yeah. We can't start with just the five of you that are all talking about
it. Yeah, exactly. So we had some vendors that were with us previously on Wednesdays that were really, really excited to come back. So a couple of farmers in particular.
Mm-hmm.
We had a few that were with us back then that weren't excited to come back either because they had a little bit of trauma over the way the thing closed so suddenly. Maybe Wednesday signifies COVID for them. I don't know.
Yeah.
And that whole thing. And then some, you know, as Justine said, that have made other plans. And vendors in general, especially grocery vendors, even as we're refilling our really big market on Saturdays, there's a lot of vendors that have disappeared in the last year.
Yeah,
so they've taken a job or they're home with kids where they're still not comfortable sending them back to school or they've moved out of town to be nearer to family while they were quarantining and just aren't coming back. So there's a whole host of vendors, some of them were fairly long-term vendors that just aren't around anymore. So
a
there's
lot of a life shifting in general. Yeah,
for sure. A little bit of a shortage of grocery vendors. Some of them have figured out how to sell online.
Yeah.
You know, figured out other methods.
Yeah.
So even refilling the spaces at that really big, huge, busy market, we're having to kind of take time on that to make sure we curate properly and that we're not just filling space. We're filling space with the right vendor, the right category of product.
Yeah.
So Wednesday's the same way. But it's actually been lovely.
Yes.
We were both there on Wednesday, and I was, like, really blown away. Mm-hmm. I was just there taking photos and shopping and saying hi and meeting new vendors and introducing myself because I won't be working on-site on Wednesdays. But it was, like, the vibe was great, and there was a lot of new faces, a lot of new really cool vendors that are either totally new business operators or just vendors that we didn't really have space for before because we had long-term vendors that were in a similar category or that space was just filled. But there is, I don't know, it just was really fun to kind of, like, meet new family members type of thing.
Yeah, it was great.
Expand your family. If that always happens when we open a new market. This has always happened when we open a new market or we take over a market. It's always just felt like, oh, your family's getting bigger.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like a whole new thing. And it's a different vibe on Wednesdays. I know when it was open pre-COVID, it was a Wednesday morning, but, you know, opening starts at 7 and I have little kids, so I was getting them to school. So I didn't work that market on site very much, but I would go there because I would take my kids to school and then I would do my grocery shopping that day.
Yeah.
Because it was so much easier than trying to do your grocery shopping on the weekends for someone with little kids sometimes. So I got a lot of, like, my mom friends, we'd meet up there and, like, shop, and we always had great farmers there and great new vendors and new businesses, and we got to really, like, nurture them and watch them kind of grow and expand and stuff. So it's that market's always been, like, such a great idea to do that market there in the middle of the week. And I loved shopping there, so it's been nice to have it back.
And it is a great incubator. We've got a lot of new vendors there. People,
for sure.
Vendors that are completely new to farmers markets and were never able to take that step before. So it's been really fun. We love incubating new businesses. And a lot of vendor 101 grads there.
Yeah. And we always talk to other market managers that have a busy market that feel kind of the same overwhelm. Like, oh, I don't want to kick anybody out, obviously, but I have these great new applicants or new young farmers that want to get into a market. And I don't have space in my busy, like, weekend market. And, you know, they're thinking about opening a weekday market to kind of complement that. And, you know, I always say, like, if your community can, you know, tolerate it and you have the interest in it and you have a space for it and you have enough people interested, it's always kind of a good idea to have that double market in the same area going on. So,
So this is something, too, that as a vendor, you know, was always kind of hard. But I think San Diego Markets does a really good job of managing this. But when you start a new market, you know, you never really know what your first day is going to be like. You don't know what the first couple weeks are going to be like. And sometimes you have a really great first day. And then, you know, because, like, the news comes out to the market and there's a lot of PR and a lot of buzz and a lot of excitement. And then week two is a little less. Then week three is really hard. And then, you know, it takes some time to really get its sea legs. And so you guys have a good way of kind of managing that and making sure that vendors don't, like, jump ship after the first couple weeks. So how long did you...
Yeah, so we've always required that a new vendor come in and commit to 6 consecutive weeks. And it's at a new market, it's especially important because, again, you're building that customer loyalty and making sure that people can trust you. We teach in our Vendor 101 classes, vendors need to realize that they're not necessarily going to kill it the first day. It's going to take people a while to get used to them and to trust them. I mean, we are people that pop up in tents and then go away. Who the heck are these folks? So it takes customers a while to get used to you. And so to give them a better chance of success, we always require that 6 consecutive weeks. A lot of time on a new market, we'll require 12 consecutive weeks from our new vendors, anybody that's starting in that market. And again, it's to give the market time to get its sea legs and develop trust with customers. That first day, you're correct. This is a really classic pattern that at a new market, it's really busy the first day because it's a grand opening and everybody wants to see what's new. And then it drops. You know, it's people are busy and it's not on the news. And then the next week is and then the week after that, it starts to build a little bit. You've got those repeat customers from the first day or two, and then you've got some new customers, and then the word gets out, and then, you know, they're talking to people. So it takes a while to build, and having those vendors committed, those farmers committed for the first 12 weeks is really important. What we did this time, actually, is we required the 6 weeks. But if you committed for 12 weeks, you got a deal. So you get your 11th and 12th week rent-free.
That's
so
nice.
If you don't miss a market in those first 12 weeks. So we were trying to make it less rules and penalties and more catching people doing things right and rewarding people for helping us to build the market. And we've always at our markets given founding vendors a little bit better rate, and we've held on to that rate for the first year or two at least in recognition of the fact that they helped build the market. So that's a good way to get your vendors to realize that this is a process and that working together we can build a market that people will be really loyal to. Brand new vendors end up in great central locations in the market versus vendors that come in later as we expand. They tend to end up farther out from the center. So starting a new market is always a good thing. But yeah, that commitment to consecutive weeks to start out benefits the farmers and vendors, and it also, of course, benefits the market.
And I think also when you choose something like 12 weeks, you're telling the vendor, like, we're going to be here, even if the first month sucks, even if the second month is hard, we're here for the long haul. And I think also we're lucky in that we have a very successful Saturday market, so we have a very clear track record of we know how to operate markets, we know our community, this is going to work out, but it is kind of like a... it shows that we both have skin in the game, both right. the market operator and the vendors.
Right.
Yeah, we have a good reputation for keeping markets open. So people know that the new vendors know that they're not going to join a market that's just going to close and it's going to kind of all be for nothing because right. they were just building up their customer base and then the market closes.
Yeah. So you want to make a strong commitment when you open a new market. It is fun for us that we typically, when we open a new market, tend to bring along at least a couple of vendors who are really OG kind of vendors, and they go back to the first days of what is now a huge, bustling market, and can tell other vendors, oh, yeah, I remember when the Mercado looked like this. Mm-hmm. And we'll have new vendors to say, what now? Because they're used to coming to the Mercado and seeing it shoulder to shoulder and talking to the old vendors and hearing that every market starts small. You could bowl down the street without harming anyone the first year of the Mercado, which is now so slammed.
Yeah.
But every market starts and builds.
Takes that build up. Yeah, I don't think markets open to massive crowds and just stay
packed
the whole time. It really is like we talk about like you kind of getting up to the top of the roller coaster, and that's like your first day. You're at the very top, and then you go, whoo, and it kind of drops. And then you're going to go up and down, up and down, up and down for a little bit as it kind of builds up. And then after a few months, you'll figure out what your consistent traffic is going to be there.
Yeah.
And it is a new market, and it all comes down to people just don't know about it yet because it's new.
Sure.
I mean, people go to older markets because they know about it because enough people have gone there that they talk to each other about it. So just getting that marketing and that word out is really helpful.
Yeah. But a unique thing about the situation is that the market was open before and, you know, you went through that whole process when you launched the market.
Mm-hmm.
It was around for about 18 months, 2 years, and then it shut down. So there is kind of this, like, for some people that were aware of it before, this preconceived idea of what it was or the feel that it had, and now it really is different. So there were a few things that we did of just like kind of like a little rebranding in a way or kind of like a refocusing or just kind of shifting a little bit in the way that this market is now operated. It's still the Little Italy Wednesday market, but not necessarily as it was pre-COVID.
True. Mm-hmm. So the last time we opened the Wednesday market a few years ago, before all this happened, we really wanted it to be groceries for the locals, for the chefs right in the area that didn't want to deal with crowds on Saturdays. Now, as Little Italy continues to evolve, and we did open the Wednesday market for just a minute last December as a holiday market.
Mm-hmm.
So we had sort of a maker's market thing there. We had a few farmers. We had some grocery products that could be characterized as gifts, like honey and jams and things. And we sort of skewed it to, we were only open for 4 weeks, and we skewed it to people that were doing holiday shopping.
Mm-hmm.
And we found that people loved it. So they loved coming out on Wednesday to kind of browse the shop. It was like having a little boutique in the middle of the neighborhood on Wednesdays.
Yeah.
So this time when we opened the Wednesday market, we set it the same way. We added some makers, we added some crafters, we've got some, you know, hand-painted jackets and candles and that kind of thing along with the farmers and vendors, and people seem to be loving it.
Yeah.
So we've given them a chance. We love makers markets too. It's not something that we've specialized in the past. That's been a little piece of our larger markets. We've always been very farm forward, and we still have really strong farmers at this market, but we do have the makers now. So it's a little bit different. We also, we felt really funny the last time we opened the Wednesday market about just calling it the Mercado. And right or wrong, we decided to brand it very distinctly as the Wednesday market.
Mm-hmm.
I think so that you wouldn't have people that were used to the really big market on Saturday coming out to Wednesday and going, oh, wait, this isn't the Mercado?
Yeah.
And they say, oh, the Mercado is only 2 blocks.
Yeah.
Or
so they think that they
disappointed.
Thought, they thought that, like, the market in Little Italy was downsizing or something. Just,
yeah.
It was like, you know, causes that confusion.
Well, this time we decided we're going to take a chance on
that.
So.
Well, even when we did separate it, we still got people that were
That's right.
I went and it's, you know,
It's small.
Yeah, it's a small weekday market. And it's like, well, actually, it's 6 blocks on Saturday. So, you know.
And having rebuilt the Mercado during COVID, having to had, I mean, we had to take the Mercado down, the Saturday market down to 2 blocks.
Yeah.
And then it rebuilt.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still rebuilding it. But it immediately got very busy again as soon as we were allowed to be busy again.
Yeah.
And so our sense now that any perception that you have of the Wednesday market could possibly affect the Saturday market in a bad way, we're over that.
Yeah.
It's like, come at me.
Yeah.
We don't come at me, bro.
We don't think that's going to happen. So we're trying to make it a more cohesive thing. It's in exactly the same location, less blocks on Wednesday than it is on Saturday, but exactly the same spot. The Mercato is a well-loved name because it's the Italian version of market, and we're in Little Italy. We frankly don't want to run
yet another set of social.
Yeah. So, yeah, we had a separate Instagram page, and that was just a lot.
It was a lot, yeah. Separate Facebook
and
page.
And I think in a lot of ways it's smart because we do have a very successful Saturday market. Mm-hmm. We want people to know about the Wednesday market.
Yeah.
What better way to use our very large Instagram following than to promote the Wednesday market
right.
on mm-hmm. on our main page? It saves us a lot of time.
Yeah.
It makes it there might be a little bit of confusion of I went to the Wednesday market looking for the
right.
Brazilian guys, Brazilian food, and I couldn't find it because they're not there. And just say, oh, hey, they're only a Saturday vendor. You know,
mm-hmm.
It actually opens up the opportunity to converse about some things.
Yeah, totally.
Or to interest people in other vendors, and maybe they'll go check out vendors that they wouldn't normally shop from. So it just kind of opens up that conversation and is what it is. And I feel like that's the best plan.
Yeah, so it seems to be going really well
yeah.
that we say, you know, visit us at the Wednesday or Saturday Mercado. It actually
mm-hmm.
streamlined our permits a little bit. So
we
now have a single permit from the Ag Department
mm-hmm.
and I think from Health. Actually, no, Health is still separate, but maybe next year we can combine them.
Mm-hmm.
But the Ag Department gives us a single permit that just says the Mercado happens on Saturdays and Wednesdays.
Yeah.
And we're hoping to convert some of our other permits to that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just simpler. One cohesive brand,
yeah.
up the social media presence, where it keeps us busy all week on social media.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was kind of a bummer. The last market that I worked before everything got shut down for COVID was the Wednesday market on Wednesday, March 11th. And People Magazine was at
That's
our market
right.
doing a photo shoot with Julia Louise Dreyfus.
That's right.
With Gilbert Quinto's farm.
I didn't realize that was the last
that
day.
Was the
that
last
was the last
day that markets were open in San Diego. Well, the following day, somebody had a Thursday market. But they, yeah.
Yeah, so that was the last, like, San Diego market day.
Yeah.
Was what that we were allowed to operate as normal before they shut everything down, and then they allowed us to reopen, shut down again, allowed us to reopen again, and then we kind of trickled along.
That was a People cover a few months later.
People Magazine. So then it came out in April, you know, in the thick of the pandemic, and we're like, look, guys, we were on People Magazine, but this market's not open right now.
Actually, People Magazine contacted me and said, mm-hmm. so would you like us to mention the Wednesday market? I'm like, no. The Wednesday market's not operating right now because of COVID. Just say Mercado.
Yeah, just say the little Mercado.
Yeah.
So
great pictures of Julia Louise Dreyfus.
I know, it's wild.
Yeah, we'll have to reshare those.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I remember I tried to take a picture of her and her handler told me to delete it out of my phone. I go, this is my market, buddy.
Yeah. Well, power struggle there.
Oh,
that was exciting.
That was so exciting, though, but then we were like, you know, and you know, the weeks leading up to the shutdown, obviously we knew things were going on, so it was kind of a weird time, but it was still really exciting, and that sticks in people's minds, I think. So it's like, you know, people remembered us.
Yeah.
So now we're back.
So advice for market managers thinking of reopening a market, or, you know, maybe their market has been dormant and they've been waiting for the right time.
Well, Kat made a good point, I think, when we had the pop-up for the holiday market. That was a good gauge to say, hey, are people, like, available during the day on this day anymore? Like, because we live in the Little Lily Market, and I know a lot of markets are in, like, residential areas, right? And then we were close to downtown, so people who are working downtown could come, like, on their lunch breaks. And we're like, how is this going to work now that, like, a lot of people are working at home and still working at home or have transitioned to working at home? So it's good if you're not sure, like, what your community is doing on the day and time that you would like to reopen your market, maybe have a pop-up farmers.
Yeah.
You could even have a pop-up farmers market and say, hey, farmers and vendors, we're going to have like four Thursday mornings or four Tuesday evenings or something. And just, hey, we'd come out to the market. And then you can kind of see what your attendance would look like and you can make a better gauge. If people are like, hey, we're not available then. Are you crazy? Like, we're not going to drive to this spot on this day and time. Then you can maybe shift your kind of goals and what you're going to do. But I think having a pop-up was good. It was nice on Wednesdays to see people. I know it was a holiday thing, but it was still like the middle of the day and middle of the week.
Yeah.
So people came out and shopped, and it kind of gave us a good gauge of if the Wednesday market would still work, and it does. So I'd say if your market has been lying dormant, try a pop-up first if you can. If, you know, gauge your community, maybe ask on social media or send out an email newsletter. You can always take a survey. Like Justine was saying, we asked a lot of our farmers and vendors, hey, are you even available to do this anymore? So what's your interest level there?
I think the whole key is remember that it's a new day. Uh-huh. And so don't just assume that we should do it the way we've always done it, because clearly, uh-huh. after the last year and a half to almost 2 years now, nothing is the same as it used to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so rather than say, oh, let's do this again, say, let's do this.
Yeah.
And what's the best way to do that, as yeah. opposed to just assuming that you should go back to the way it was. Nothing's the way it was.
Uh-huh.
Let's just start new.
Yeah.
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 And then when you do decide that it's something you do, make sure that you're, you know, using, practicing all those things that you would for your other market or mm-hmm. for the way that you did before. Get those email newsletters out. Kat, you know, bumped up those email newsletters. Now we're sending out 2 a week. We're sending
That's
out
right.
one for Wednesday mm-hmm. and one for Saturday. And even though in many ways those brands have merged, we're still hitting it hard with those email newsletters and really clearly communicating who's at the market Wednesday, mm-hmm. who's at the market Saturday, and getting our social media messaging out and making sure, you know, this time of the week we're promoting this market and this time of the week we're promoting this market, and we're doing it all together, but making it as clear as possible for shoppers. So
yeah, we're even putting Wednesday and Saturday in our subject lines of our newsletters right mm-hmm. now, just so people are really clear.
Oh, that's
we're doing
smart.
Everything possible to reinforce this is a Wednesday market, this is a Saturday market. It's so funny when you talk about the newsletters, because we are faithful to those newsletters.
Mm-hmm.
When I say we, I mean me.
It's the queen's we.
That's
yeah.
right.
It's the queen's we.
That's right. Well, in this case, it's also the individual we, because I'm usually pounding away on those newsletters on Friday mornings. But
no,
it's funny
what.
How dependent your shoppers will get on those if you're really, really consistent about them. I can't remember what happened. I was on a delayed flight or something, and the newsletter didn't get out on Friday afternoon for the Saturday market. And we actually had 3 people contact us and say, is the market canceled tomorrow? I'm like, why are people asking this? It's like, oh, they didn't get the newsletter yet.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
sent it out early on Saturday morning, put everybody's fears aside.
Yeah. Just remind them what day it is. I mean, yeah. we are living in like a time space continuum.
That's right.
I don't know what day it is. I don't know where we are. I don't know what's going on. Where am I supposed to be right now? So I like it when people remind me what day is coming
sure.
up
yeah.
and what day I should be where. So just tell them. Tell them where to go.
Yeah.
Hey guys, tomorrow's Wednesday. Go to the market at 9:30.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I will say that it's been good too for our staff, because a lot of our staff had. We had way more staff than we used to, because we had mm-hmm. to cover so many posts at the market,
mm-hmm.
but all of those staff members were getting less hours.
Yeah.
It was very intensive 1 day a week, and the second market does give some of our staff a chance to pick up some more hours. And,
yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually how we've started a lot of weekday markets in the past, is
yeah.
that we wanted a way to make our staff closer to full-time.
Yeah.
Because we wanted to keep these really well-trained, wonderful staff members, and we needed more for them to do. So.
Yeah, we've had great market staff that are like, hey, I can't keep working like 10 hours a week. I need some more to do. We're like, okay, we'll open a market for you. Please
yeah.
don't go.
By the way, I don't necessarily recommend
yeah,
that. Honestly, in retrospect, we've started some wonderful markets, many of which we've transitioned over to different people to run now that we got our, you know, came back to our senses. But
now that we're aging.
Gracefully. Yeah, that too. But it is a way to be able to hold on to better staff,
mm-hmm.
is to have multiple markets for them to work at.
Yeah. And it's, you know, better income for you too as a market
sure.
manager. If this is your gung-ho about it, it's another stream of income as
yeah.
having another
yeah.
market. So just do it correctly so it doesn't end up being, you don't want your bigger market to be funding your smaller market.
Yeah.
So just be careful that you're, you know, looking at your numbers consistently.
That's another whole episode topic.
I'm writing that down.
Yeah, yeah. That happens a lot, and sometimes it's for a good reason. It's
uh-huh.
so that a large, busy market in maybe a very high-income area can subsidize a market that's bringing food to an area that is not as busy. But again, that's
mm-hmm.
a topic for another
yeah.
episode.
But mm-hmm. I do have to say one more thing about kind of the unique situation that we're in and that some market managers may be in, is that our big market is still not as big as it once was.
True.
And with all the turnover of the last year and a half, 2 years, you know.
And having to keep all those spaces open for
yeah.
COVID protocols, we had to leave every other space empty. And I think that was true in a lot of areas around the country.
Mm-hmm.
When it's come back and the board has said, oh, call all those folks to come back, it's
they're
like
not
they're not there. They weren't in suspended animation waiting for us to reopen.
Mm-hmm. So the Wednesday market has become a really beautiful pipeline of new vendors, people that maybe aren't ready to like hit the ground running at a gigantic, big urban Saturday market, but they
mm-hmm.
can start out on Wednesday. They can get in the flow of doing markets. They can build, you know, even just doing the production for a Saturday market is
mm-hmm.
daunting for some new vendors. So, you know, it gives us a chance to bring in some new vendors that may eventually be able to be vendors at our big Saturday market.
Yeah.
And so it's a nice, it works out really nicely.
Yeah. There's a lot of benefits to having
yeah.
it. Yep, for sure.
Yep.
Yep. And you can just get those no parking signs, double up on them. And let your community know, like let your neighbors know that it's reopening and so that they're not parking there saying, hey, I thought that market closed. So I'll always be that parking advocate.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. We did have to remind everybody that that this street is not only closed to parked cars on Saturdays, but again on Wednesdays.
Also Wednesdays. But you're welcome for the vegetables in your neighborhood. All right. Well,
yeah. So good luck. Opening those new markets has been quiet for a while. Yeah, yes. I think it'll be fun. I'm going to guess that actually most markets that haven't opened yet are not going to open this year.
Yeah, I'm wondering what the percentage is. It'd be great if we could get some feedback from people. If you have either reopened your one market after staying closed for a while during COVID or an additional market that you had, you let one stay dormant, we'd love to hear about it. So you can always send us an email at connect@farmersmarketpros.com or DM us through Instagram or message us on Facebook or post in the farmers market community. And let's talk about it, because I know I'm assuming that people are thinking about it still, even if they haven't opened it and they're not
planning
to open it now.
That's right, might be planning for spring.
Yeah, planning for the springtime.
So. Yeah, I know that there's some big organizations that have a whole bunch of markets that have reopened maybe 70% of their markets, but don't have the staffing or vendor bandwidth or farmer bandwidth to open that last 30%, and a lot of them are pushing till next spring. They've decided that this is just, they need to concentrate on what they can do well right now.
Yeah, which makes sense too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thanks for listening today. Tent Talk, the Farmers Market Podcast, is a weekly resource made possible by the attendees and sponsors of Intense, the Farmers Market Conference. When you attend the next annual conference in March 2022, in addition to gaining knowledge, networking, and inspiration, you'll also have the satisfaction of knowing that you helped support the ongoing education provided here on Tent Talk, the Farmers Market Podcast. Super early bird pricing ends this week, so register today and save at intenseconference.com or by clicking Conference 2022 at farmersmarketpros.com.
Farmers markets are all about connection, and all of us, operators, farmers, and vendors, keep learning. Join us at the 6th annual Intense the Farmers Market Conference in San Diego, California on March 7th, 8th, and 9th, 2022 to grow your market and your community. Connect over in our private Facebook group, the Farmers Market Pros Community, with active farmers market managers and participants. You can also message us on Instagram @farmersmarketpros or email us at connect@farmersmarketpros.com. To further your farmers market education, check out our online courses at farmersmarketpros.com. Thanks so much for listening to Tent Talk. Please leave us a review wherever you access your podcasts, and be sure you subscribe so you don't miss the next episode. Tent Talk, the Farmers Market Podcast, is proudly produced by Farmers Market Pros, where passion meets profit. Today's episode was recorded and edited by Justine Marzoni-Mead. Original music by David Mead. Thank you so much for listening today, and we'll have another great episode next week. Tune in.